Welcome back to the series on number formats. This is a general series on how we represent binary numbers in the digital system, how we visualize them, how arithmetic operations are done on them, and all the myriad of problems that are associated with them that we need to keep in mind when we're dealing with them. This series is geared towards people interested in general computing, but the examples have an emphasis in the audio domain. Let's get started. I had previously introduced the concept of the fixed point format in the earlier videos. Today, we're going to talk about the motivations for the need of a new number format, the floating point format. So, what are we trying to solve when we're implementing floating point numbers? What problems with fixed point numbers should this new representation format address? If you look back into the previous videos and count the number of times I said overflow, but you always have to be aware of arithmetic overflow. Overflow, the overflow, possible overflow, 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 an overflow. The overflow is overflow for overflows with overflow. And I'm going to sound like a broken record now. Overflow is still a concern.
That's a ludicrous number of times to be stating overflow in 40 minutes of content. And I'm sorry about that. But it seems like it's an issue, right? I mean, if just adding two arbitrary numbers could result in a number that would never fit into the space that it was allocated for and would flow over it, then it's a problem. More generally, range is the problem. The range is limited with the fixed point number format, and we need to address that. The other issue that we saw was with accuracy, or rather the lack of accuracy when dealing with division operations. Furthermore, the accuracy is significantly lower at the lower end of the range for fixed point numbers, and isn't so much of an issue at the higher end of the range. We need a number format where the accuracy is consistent across the full range of numbers. Let's try to address these two issues, range and accuracy. We'll take a look at range first. Let's take a step back and look at how scientists deal with really large and really small numbers. Take the weight of the Earth, for example. That's a lot when represented in decimal. It's a lot more when represented in binary. You need 84 bits to store this. That's not even the worst part. The nearest power of 2 register that can store this number is 128 bits in size. You don't find 128-bit primitive types in computer languages. You'll have to roll with your own. But doing that, you'd also have a significant performance hit, since they can't be held in a single CPU register, which in a 64-bit architecture is 64 bits in length. Also, this value lays out zeros after 5 significant digits. That doesn't mean that the mass of the Earth is exactly this value. It just means that our observations and calculations are accurate only to about 5 significant digits. Or it could also mean that we just don't care about the accuracy beyond the 5 digits represented here. I mean, what does a few thousand kilograms matter when compared to the mass of the Earth? What about really small numbers? Let's take this number for instance. It's an approximation of a universal constant in theoretical physics called Planck's length. Doesn't matter what it is, but it's an exceedingly small number as you can see. How would this be represented in binary? Sort of like this. I had to actually constrain the final value to 128 bits, because this fraction can't exactly be represented in binary, since it results in a non-recurring, non-terminating series of numbers that stretches on forever. What I've represented here is an approximation. The next video will actually talk about approximations and how limiting the binary number system is when we want to exactly represent a value. But for now, it seems quite silly to be representing these sort of really small or really large numbers in fixed point notation. How do scientists deal with these numbers? Well, they use the scientific notation. I'm sure you've seen this representation before, and it's very convenient. You can represent any arbitrary decimal number in scientific notation with two parts. A real number called the mantissa, multiplied by the base of the number system to the power of an exponent. Here, the mantissa would represent the accuracy of the number. The lengthier it is, the more accurate the entire number is. And the exponent signifies the scale of the number. A positive exponent signifies a number bigger than 1, and a negative exponent would represent a number between 0 and 1. Now, this notation is a lot more expressive. You can already envision ways of representing these numbers in binary. You can essentially have two fixed point numbers, one for the mantissa and one for the exponent. And you can build some rules into the representation system, such that the number is always normalized, meaning there'll always be one digit to the left of the radix point, and this digit shouldn't be a zero. If it isn't normalized, like in this case, the exponent is adjusted such that the normalized form is achieved. If you do this, you don't have to worry about the position of the radix point at all. It's always after one digit. Another rule you could have is that the base that's raised to the exponent is always the base of the number system. Very good. So we only need two identifiable integer numbers, one for the mantissa and one for the exponent. But we don't want two separate numbers to keep track of one number, so we can merge them together so that the first m bits would contain the mantissa, and then some e bits after that would contain the exponent. And let's throw in a sign bit there as well, just to keep track of the sign of the number, either positive or negative. And here we have the makings of the floating point number format. The reason it's called floating point is because the radix position isn't fixed to one single position. The exponent would decide where the radix point should be. This is great. We have the blueprints for a floating point number format. What's all the fuss? Why is this number hard to work with? Seems convenient enough. Well, I've only been talking about representing these numbers in decimal for convenience. In digital hardware, it needs to be in binary. This number here, when converted to binary, would look like this. That's a bit confusing. There are only zeros and ones, and the base has to be changed to 2 because it's binary. And the exponent is a binary number as well. Let's look at this number now. When we convert it to binary, we get this. Now, this is a lot more confusing and doesn't make much sense. The decimal number clearly has a terminating mantissa. It has a fixed number of digits. But why does the binary number not? It seems to have a recurring and non-terminating series of numbers. To understand the problem, we need to take a deeper look at the number line and realize that most numbers that we encounter on a daily basis are just an approximation and never exact.